I'm Mayor Dave J. Markowitz. I have called this meeting in accordance with the city charter, section 7-2, which is our annual budget policy requirement. Before we get started, I would like to ask the administrative assistant to the city council to call the roll of the city council and school committee.
Counselor Bidwell?
Here.
Counselor Carney? Counselor Dwight?
Here.
Counselor Klein?
Here.
Counselor LaBarge?
Here.
Counselor Murphy?
Here.
Counselor Nash?
Here.
Counselor O'Donnell?
Here.
Counselor Shara?
Here.
Mr. Baird?
Here.
Ms. Burnham?
Here.
Ms. Busansky?
Present.
Ms. Fallon?
Here.
Ms. Hennessy?
Present.
Mr. Meyer? Mr. Moore?
Here.
Mayor Narkowitz?
Present.
Mr. Reed?
Present.
Mr. Zahowski?
Present.
Okay, so I believe we have a healthy quorum of both bodies. I also wanted to make note of the fact that Dr. Provost, the superintendent of Northampton Public Schools, is here, as well as Candace Walsland, the business manager, administrator of the Northampton Public Schools. Susan Wright, finance director, is here. We also have some of my colleagues from Smith Vocational and Agricultural High School, including interim superintendent Kevin Farr, who I think said hello to some of you, as well as the chair, Michael Kaelane, and also fellow trustee Jack Cotton is here. I just want to acknowledge them also here for the presentation. So I have a lot of information I'm going to try to cover really quickly, as I always do, hitting the lights. For those of you who have computers, it is linked on the homepage of the Northampton City website, so you'll be able to find it there as well if you want to pull up the slides. Okay, so quickly, the things I'm going to try to cover tonight. We're going to do our comparisons. We always try to do some metric comparisons with other communities of similar size. We're going to look at our revenue and expenditure trends. We're going to look at our five-year fiscal stability plan, see where that is. We're going to look at our revenue and expenditure projections for 2018, the upcoming fiscal year budget. We're going to look at the calendar for fiscal year 2018. And I'm going to just answer any questions or comments that you have. Again, first up is, sorry, that was the agenda. First up is the comparison with neighboring communities. We chose a set of neighboring communities. Some of them are larger, some of them are smaller. We tried to find communities that have either like-sized populations, like-sized budgets, or they're near us in proximity, like East Hampton. We don't have Williamsburg because they're just so much smaller than us. It's a really good kind of set of communities to compare. So this is the average single-family home value. The state average is $399,473. You can see Northampton in blue is at $303,705, and then you can see sort of how they scale out with Longmeadow at the top, all the way down to Greenfield, Holyoke, and Chicopee. Comparison with neighboring communities, average single family tax bill. This is based on FY 2017 numbers. The state average is $5,621. Northampton, you can see again, sort of third there, $5,069 is our average tax bill. You can see Longmeadow, which is sort of the high at $8,243, all the way down to Chicopee. Neighboring communities' residential tax rate. This compares the residential tax rate. You can see Northampton at $16.69 is among the lowest in the residential tax rate category. Longmeadow at $23.58 is the champion, and I believe they still have retained their title as the highest residential tax rate in the Commonwealth based on the latest survey. Next is the commercial tax rate. Again, we have a single tax rate, so our $16.69 rate for commercial, again, puts us in the lower tier of the comparison communities. I would also note that Boston Business Journal just did its annual survey of commercial tax rates around the state, and Northampton was number 202 out of the 340-some
rates that it looked at. So we have a very low and competitive commercial tax rate, which we believe makes us very attractive and is also supportive of many small and locally owned businesses that we have in Northampton. This is undesignated fund balance. This is basically what's also called free cash. This was the certification numbers at the end of 2017. It basically shows you, you can see Northampton with 4.2 million in the center, and then there's a range, Agawam up $12 million all the way down to Longmeadow. Again, free cash or undesignated fund balance is what the DOR certifies after the close of the fiscal year. It's basically the resolution between what you budgeted, versus what you spent, and the additional monies comes back to us in the form of additional fund balance. Then we'll talk a little bit later about how we use that. It's important to note when we look at some of these slides that the way communities decide to set up how they use their reserve funds can also dictate some of the variations here. You know, the mayor of Agawam, $12 million, I was actually with him today at a meeting. They pretty much just keep everything in free cash. They don't tend to move it into other stabilization accounts. You'll see later they have a really low stabilization amount, but that's because they just tend to keep it in free cash. Next slide is new growth. You can see that our new growth FY 2017, 733,076, again, we're the dark blue, and you can kind of see the range is above us, Westfield, a little over $1 million. Again, same with Amherst and West Springfield, and then down actually Longmeadow at 179. This obviously fluctuates from year to year. It's really based on the number of new units that come onto your tax rolls as of July 1st, whether it's a commercial building or a residential building, anything that's new. And so new growth, you get to add to your tax levy in addition to going up to 2.5%. This is actually a comparison of unemployment. This is taken directly from the DOR's revenue data bank. This is for FY 2017. Good news for Northampton, we have the lowest unemployment rate of the comparison communities, 2.9%. And then you can see sort of the range all the way up to 6.1% for Holyoke. This is, again, that comparison I mentioned before, the stabilization fund, and now you can see suddenly Agawam looks really small and Northampton looks really big. Again, it's part of it is accounting, and we'll see later that we tend to create, because we have the four enterprise funds, we've created stabilization accounts for each one of those. We've also set up stabilization, capital stabilization, and we also have the fiscal stability fund that we created after the override in 2013. So again, here we show a really strong stabilization fund balance in comparison to our neighbors. This is a really interesting slide. This is the comparison with neighboring communities, and it's looking at our FY17 budgets, and it's looking at the percentage of each budget, general fund budget, by revenue source. So the blue in the bottom is basically your taxes, your property taxes. You can see Northampton, 49.62% of its FY2017 budget relies on that as part of its makeup. The green in the middle is actually state aid. Interestingly, Northampton at 14.68%, other than Longmeadow, is among the lowest of all those communities in terms of how much of its budget is made up of state aid. Then you can move up. I'm staying with Northampton. We then have one of the largest in terms of local receipts. Again, that's other than the property tax, other than state aid. For us, that's things like the hotel motel tax, it's the meals taxes, it's the other revenues, excise, the other local revenues that we've either opted into to create. And then there's the sort of the other rates, other receipts from other sources. But I think it's a really important slide. It shows in some ways that, you know, we receive among the least state aid of our comparison communities, but also that we've had to rely on creating other local revenue sources. And we're always obviously talking to our legislators and governor about trying to give local communities more. If they're not going to give us more aid, give us more tools at the local level to create revenue. So I think that's a really interesting slide. And then again, look at Holyoke. 54% of their budget, more than half, is state aid. And again, that's relative to the fact that the challenges they have and the poverty level, they receive a much larger amount of state aid. Next slide is, this is looking at per pupil education spending. Again, this is taken from DESE. It's 2015 numbers, which are the most recent numbers. I've included both of our school districts, Smith Voc and Northampton. It's a little bit hard. I mean, we're the only city in the Commonwealth that has two school districts. So we already don't compare really well on that side. And you also have to take into account that Smith Vocational, as a Voc Tech school, the cost per pupil is higher for Voc Tech schools generally. I didn't want to omit it, so I wanted to show it. Most of these other communities, their spending on Voc Tech is in these numbers already, because in the case of like Westfield or Chicopee, they have Voc Tech schools within their district, or the sending tuitions in some cases are included. So this shows you what we're spending, $14,056.81 in the Northampton public schools per pupil, and then $24,278.95. So in the next slide, this, which isn't from DESE, although all the numbers are, we tried to create a hybrid, basically blend the two together to take the number of students, again, the Northampton students that we're spending funds on per pupil, and then all the Northampton public schools. And we created a hybrid of the two numbers, and it actually comes up to about $15,333 per student when you kind of blend the two together. So that's the best representation we can give you of per pupil spending in Northampton for both kids that go to the NPS and kids that go to Smith Voc. Because again, on the cherry sheets at DESE, basically it's treated as two separate districts. So again, that's a comparison. You can see Amherst at $20,000 plus per student. This is comparisons of general government spending. These next few categories are the categories that you see. These are Munis categories, but they're also the categories you see in our general fund budget. General government would be the mayor, the city council, the city clerk, legal, HR, et cetera. You can see that 5.81% of our budget is sort of right in the middle in terms of our spending on general government. And then you can see the variations on either side. This is public safety as a percentage of the budget. You can see 14.33% of our budget is spent on public safety. You can see we're right up near the top, 15 in Holyoke, and then 14 in the next tier, and then it goes down from there. That's public safety as a percentage of the general fund budget. This is public works, 4.87%. This is, again, one of those numbers that you have to take into account significant variation in how each community funds their public works. In this case of Northampton, this is only showing you general fund budget spending. We have four separate enterprise funds that fund key functions of our Department of Public Works. In some cases, we have communities. I know, for example, my colleague in West Springfield, he would like to have a more vigorous sewer enterprise fund, but he's spending much of the funding towards sewer repairs out of the general fund, and they're consistently having issues trying to make those. So we're at 4.87, but the variations, it's hard to kind of figure out who has enterprise funds, who doesn't. So this is just general fund. This is culture and recreation spending as a percentage of the budget. So this would be the spending that we do on arts and culture, the Parks and Rec Department. You can see pretty much, Chicopee and Northampton at 2.4, 2.6. Amherst is 4.7. I'm not actually convinced that they're spending twice as much. We actually think that one is because of the way they assign healthcare costs in their budget. But we haven't had a chance to investigate that further. But that shows you what our culture and rec spending is relative to other communities. The next one is debt spending. So what we're spending on debt service in the general fund budget. Northampton, 6.77% of general funding spent on debt. And you can see Greenfield all the way down to Amherst. Keep in mind, again, Some of the differences that can come into play here, Northampton, as part of its general fund debt, we are still paying debt service, debt exclusion on the high school, on the police station, and on the fire station. JFK came off of our debt. So again, Greenfield, I know, just built a beautiful new high school. They did a debt exclusion. I'm sure that probably accounts for the fact that they have that large percentage now going to debt. This is human services spending. We're at 1.5%. Again, the variations are a little different. I mean, Greenfield's at 1.8%, 1.7, 1.5, 1.5. So, you know, this is a chart that the differences aren't that much. Human services would be for our senior center. It would be for, veteran services and also the health department. We also took a look at libraries. We don't actually get the number from DOR in this case. We actually get it from the Mass Board of Library Commissioners. This shows you, again, libraries in the comparison communities. As with our school districts, we have two separate libraries, two separate and distinct independent libraries. You can see Forbes Library is right up there, $45.37. That's per capita spending. So how much the municipality is spending per capita. And then you can see Lilly Library at $33.52. So that gives you a sense of how our spending on our local libraries compares to other communities. So now we're going to talk about reserves. Our reserve funds are something that I've been talking about since I became mayor. It's been a part of all these presentations. It's something that we've really been focused on over the last several years, trying to rebuild our reserves. And then in the case of the override, actually, we structured a whole budget plan and a whole multi-year budget plan around creating a reserve, building up a reserve, and then having to potentially rely on that reserve in the future. We care about it because the way that other outside agencies look at our city and rate our city, the size and health of our reserves is a very important component, which then, of course, translates into our ability to borrow money for projects in our schools and in our city. So that's why the focus on reserves. This is the history of our undesignated fund balance, and it basically shows you what that free cash at the end of the year, as we've talked about before, FY10, you'll see we had a negative balance. That means we were in the red. That was the year after the crash, the mid-year budget cuts. And then you can see over the next several years, particularly in the last four years, we've really tried to build up our undesignated fund balance. And you can see the history there. This is actually how we spend our undesignated fund balance or our free cash at the end of the year. And the color coding, I'll go through it, but I just want to say one of the other issues that we tried to work on, and that is always noted as a concern with DOR and with outside rating agencies, is how much you're using reserves to basically prop up the operating budget. The goal is you want trying to use as little reserves as possible. You want to spend operating funds on operating budgets. You tend to want to use reserves on one-time expenses. So one of the things we tried to do in the first budget, FY13 and beyond, was to get away from the heavy reliance on reserves to backfill operating expenses. So we've done a lot of work over the last 4 years on trying to really true up our budget numbers with regard to things like legal and veterans and snow and ice, so that we're not having to keep going back and dip into our free cash during the mid-year to cover operating expenses. But the way this breaks down is the yellow is capital expenditure. So you can see a big chunk of our free cash we're using to fund the capital program. And that's everything from, you know, the school roofs and police cruisers and fire trucks and just all the things that make up the capital plan. So we rely heavily on a healthy free cash balance in order to fund our capital plan. The next green, the next two greens moving up are stabilization and capital stabilization. Those are, again, our two main stabilization funds that we've been trying to build up in case of emergencies, either in capital or just general fiscal emergencies. And then the fiscal stability fund, which again was created to basically take the new revenue created by the $2.5 million override, not spend all of it, but to put it in a fund then we could rely on in future out years. So you can see that we've been using a certain amount of our free cash in 15 and 16 and putting that into fiscal stability. And then there's some other expenses that we've used it for. In some cases, we do transfers back to the school for McKinney-Vento that doesn't come to them directly, and we just transfer it back to them. In some cases, we've done transfers to pay for emergencies at the library or at Academy of Music. So that shows you how we've spent our free cash. This is our general reserve history. This is, again, not free cash, but just the main stabilization, fiscal stability, capital stabilization, and stabilization. And you can see how those have grown over the last several years as we've attempted to rebuild them from their lows. This shows you the percentage of our budget, what those reserves represent. You can see that from FY12, where reserves represented 0.33%, they're now up to 8.12% of our overall budget. And as I mentioned at the outset, how is this translated into bond rating? Again, looking at those 4 years as we ramped up to try to rebuild our bonds, we started in 2011 with an A+ negative outlook bond rating, and we've slowly progressed over the last several years until last year we received an upgrade to AAA, which is the highest bond rating possible. You can see over to the right, we've done the comparison communities. You can see Northampton is the only among the comparison communities that have the AAA bond rating, and then you can see the others. This was an excerpt from our bond rating report that was issued last year, talking about the strong management practices and financial policies. The city is conservative in its management and budgeting practices. And then the outlook statement that they included, I won't read it verbatim, but it does go on to say that if reserves were to significantly decline, resulting in a weaker budgetary performance, we could lower the rating. So they've given us strong ratings over time, and we've tried to address issues in each successive year that we've gone out for bond ratings. And again, what this translates into is when we're borrowing money, again, to fix roofs, to buy equipment, to do work in our utilities, our stormwater, our water and sewer, this gives us advantageous interest rates. Okay, general fund. These are the revenue trends for our general fund. So this basically is the FY 2017 budget that we're operating in right now. Just a quick overview. Almost $60 million of it is built on taxes of all sorts, the property tax, meals, hotel. State revenue represents about $16 million of that budget. Charges for services, about $9 million, and then you can see all the other categories that comprise the current budget. We always do this slide. Let's see, this is the new growth slide. This shows you basically the trends in new growth. Again, as I mentioned before, new growth, again, is cyclical. It's based on what kinds of new building is happening, what kinds of new growth is happening. You can see we had two really strong years in 15 and 16, up to 938,000. In FY 2017, 733,000. And again, we're hoping to have another strong year as several other new building projects come online. New growth is really important. We'll show it to you later, because it calculates how much revenue we're able to raise for each fiscal year. Uncollected taxes, again, our treasurer collector and Susan Wright and her finance team work very hard. We have a really low uncollected tax rate, 0.9%. So that's not a major issue in terms of revenue or lost revenue. Motor vehicle excise tax, again, it's been fairly strong in the last few years. People obviously must be buying new cars, and that tax is another one of our key revenues. Hotel and motel and meals, These have been, again, really important revenues for Northampton, particularly because we have such a large restaurant and visitorship economy. So that plays a really important role. Harkening back to that earlier slide where we received so little state aid, we really had to create other local revenue sources. So this is really important to our local economy. Parking and ambulance revenue. This shows you basically the two other revenue sources. Parking is the brown, ambulance is the blue. Again, been very stable the last few years. Some of the growth that you see from 10, 11, you know, up to 12 and up to 13, there were some rate changes that were done around that time, which translates into why there might have been a bump in those years. This is building, wiring, plumbing, and associated permits. Another one of those cyclical slides that shows you basically building activity in the economy, who's taking out permits to build. The one thing I'll mention about this one is in 2016, we had $700,000 in combined permit revenue. The 2017 chart is actually to date. So to date, we've already raised $500,000 in revenue. So that one appears to be trending in a really positive direction with 6 months to go. Again, there's some major building projects. Smith is embarking on a major library renovation that's going to involve a lot of permits. And so that is, again, a positive for us in terms of revenue. Fines, this is actually parking and RMV fines. I primarily wanted to show this slide because there's often a perception that we're, you know, sending people out, we're trying to constantly give out more and more tickets so we can, you know, raise our ticket revenue. As you can see, parking tickets have actually declined in the last couple of years, but pretty much remained stable. Again, there was a jump from 2011 to 2012. That's because the fine was raised from $10 to $15 for a parking ticket. So it's been fairly stable. This is enterprise fund indirect charges. Those on the council know that for each one of the four enterprise funds, those enterprise funds also pay indirect charges back to the general fund for bookkeeping, accounting, health insurance, retirement, and other services. We've really focused on these in the last several years and tried to provide a lot of detail in the budgets on those. I would only point out to you that, you know, in 15, 16, and 17, we went from three enterprise funds to four enterprise funds. We're still, the indirects are still lower than they were in 2014. The black at the top was primarily the landfill, which you can see has slowly diminished, and now it's just a really small enterprise fund for the transfer station. So those are our enterprise indirects that support the general fund. Investment income, not much I can say about that other than, you know, not much money to be made in interest when money's in the bank, really small amount. Net state aid, this is again one of these ones we look at. We actually took a more expanded view just to kind of give an even longer perspective. This is net state aid after offsets, doesn't include MSBA payments. It's based, FY 2018 is based on the governor's budget, but you can see how state aid has really fallen off, net state aid. I mean, from FY 2002, where we were receiving, you know, over $13 million, and now it's dropped off. I mean, even in 2008, 10 years ago, we were receiving three or four times what we're receiving right now. So that really gives you the picture and how smaller and smaller a role the state has been playing in funding municipal government. This is local aid unrestricted. This is what comes directly to the city. This just shows you over the last several years. The change in color is because it used to be lottery and additional, and then they combined it into one. The FY 2018 budget that the governor has introduced shows a proposed increase of $164,816 in unrestricted general governmental aid. But as you see, it's really has not gone up significantly over time. This is Chapter 70 aid. Again, another one of those that over the last 10 years has not really increased very much. The governor's budget, despite all of the grand announcements about, you know, we're putting millions and millions and millions of dollars into Chapter 70, the FY 18 governor's budget would give combined, Smith Voc and NPS, a combined increase of $57,000 for both districts. So that's what the governor's proposal in new Chapter 70 money. And again, Northampton is a minimum aid community, so generally, we're looking at really minimal increases. The governor, his last 2 years, has started the bidding with $20 per student, and you know, we'll see what the legislature does, whether they increase it or not. This shows the enrollment of our two school districts historically over the last 10 years. Important to keep in mind, the Smith Voc is just enrollment for Northampton students. It's just the Northampton students that we are funding in the public schools. You can see enrollment at NPS has remained fairly constant. There's been some fluctuations at Smith Voc, but you know, over the last 4 years, it's been around 100, 102, 103 Northampton students attending. This is actually a chart, again, that came off of DESE. We tried to put them both on there. This basically tracks, it tracks the aid, it tracks Chapter 70 aid, it tracks the foundation budget. Chapter 70 is in red. The blue lines that go up is the foundation budget requirement for NPS and for Smith Voc. The black line is required net school spending, and then the line with the little diamonds intersecting it is our actual net school spending. So you can see that we're continuing to spend at or above the net school spending requirement that the state sets. This is a tool that we found on the DESE site that allows you to compare yourself to four other communities. So obviously we made two charts because we couldn't compare do all the comparisons. We actually left Holyoke off of this one. So we compared ourselves to Amherst, Greenfield, East Hampton, and Long Meadow on the left, and then Chicopee, Westfield, Agawam, and West Springfield on the right. The red is Northampton, and it's basically showing our Chapter 70 aid per pupil. So you can see that on the left, only Long Meadow receives less Chapter 70 aid per pupil than us. And on the right, again, we receive far less than Chicopee, Westfield, Agawam, and West Springfield in terms of our Chapter 70, which has remained very flat over those years. While it's not part of our the appropriated budget, there's been a lot of conversation about federal funding, obviously, in the last 10 days. So I thought I would at least put this in here just to show people. This is not money, again, that gets included in the general fund budget. It's not something that gets appropriated. It's often a combination of grants directly to the schools. But this shows you the $3.4 million that the city is receiving in various funding sources in FY 2016. I would point out that the lion's share of that is going to the schools. USDA is the school lunch program. It's $500,000, and then $1.8 million is Department of Education funds. And then you can see some of the other Department of Homeland Security has $64,000 is what they're funding us. So that shows you what that agency is funding. Expenditures, general fund expenditures. This basically is the other pie chart that shows what we're spending our dollars on in 2017. 38.8% on education, employee benefits 20%, public safety a little under 15%, debt service 5%, and then you can see the other parts of the pie. We, as we frequently do, also show the employee benefits and some of the other health insurance benefits that get paid indirectly to the schools to show that 55.2% of our budget in FY 17 is actually going toward education spending. That's both for Smith Voc as well as the public schools. This is our general fund appropriation for education spending. Smith Voc would be the number the R on the left, NPS on the right. This shows you sort of the appropriation history over the last several years of what we're appropriating to the two school districts. This shows you the impact of students leaving our district via charter and choice. This is net of state charter reimbursement. I've showed you this chart many times. Again, this is one of the biggest challenges facing the city and our funding our school system. And we've got some more slides to kind of talk about this. This is a slide that we've done before. The numbers are probably hard to read, but basically what we do in this chart is we try to take the outgoing charter and school choice students and their dollars. We then offset it with the incoming school choice students and their dollars, plus any reimbursement that we get through charter school reimbursement. And basically at the bottom of the chart, and again, this is in FY 2017, we end up, we're net loss of 45 students and a little over $1 million, $1,040,870. We then actually took this and we tried to replicate that to our comparison communities. This is going to be even harder to see, but I'm going to just explain it to you. We basically created, again, we took all of our comparison communities. The first set of information is the charter going out. Then we have the school choice going out. Then we have the school choice coming in. And then the final column on the right is the net gain or loss. So even just going down to the bottom, Northampton's in the middle, but going down to the bottom, you can see that the average per student charter out is $10,937. The school choice average cost going out, $6,802. School choice coming in, which is sort of the way that you can try to offset those two, the average is $6,226. So it's no surprise that a total of 1,833 students, you're down 1,883 students, and you're in the hole $19 million. It's an equation that you can never win. Northampton, we're down 62.78 students and down $895,000 in that equation after the offsets for school choice and for charter. Just another way of looking at it and realizing that it's not just a Northampton issue. Only Longmeadow on that chart. Longmeadow is the only community that's netting out $219,000 out of all those communities. Everyone else, it's a losing game. Okay, that's the slide before. This is health insurance, employee benefits. Again, health insurance is one of our largest budget items, over $10 million, approaching $11 million. This shows our five-year average increase, 2.7%. Our 10-year average increase has been 2.88%. This is a major part of our budget. We won't know our health insurance number for a few more weeks. We'll be getting that from the Group Insurance Commission. They've had their public hearing. They'll be voting early in February on setting the rates for all the various health plans. This is retirement. This is set by the Northampton Retirement Board. Our assessment, again, is based on their actuarial tables. It's based on the stock market. We are slated to have an increase in our what we have to contribute to the retirement fund of about 5.34%, or a little under $300,000. But you can see the growth in retirement benefits over the last 10 years. This is public safety spending. This is police in blue, fire rescue in red, dispatch in yellow. You can see the trends there in terms of our public safety spending. This is debt service. These are a combination of both our long-term bonds, our temporary bonds. You can sort of see the trend of our debt expenditures over the last 10 years. This is our 10-year picture of general government on the left, public works on the right. You can see the changes over time. This is culture and recreation on the left. This is human services on the right. You can again see a 10-year perspective. And hopefully you'll have a chance when you download this presentation, if you want to drill down and look at some of these. I know they're harder to see in these smaller slides, but you can take a look at them. But you sort of get a sense of not a lot of massive increases. This is a really important slide. This shows Basically, over the last five fiscal years, including the current fiscal year, the total full-time equivalents in the city, that's both for general government as well as the schools, and you can basically see that we've had no significant increase. We've sort of held steady in terms of the number of employees over those 5 years at right around 1,000 employees total. Fiscal stability plan. So for those of you who were either on the council or on the committee, in June of 2013, we asked the voters to approve a $2.5 million operating override as part of a fiscal stability plan. The original plan, which is shown here, was we would spend some of that override to stabilize our budget in 2014. We would then bank the rest of it into what we call the fiscal stabilization fund. And the plan then was by 2018, by this budget year that we're going into, we would basically be in the red. We would have spent money in 14, 15, and 16. We would have then started to go into the red in 17, and we would have had a significant shortfall in 18. That was the original plan. Each year we've come back, we've revised the plan. Obviously, we've done a lot of work in terms of controlling spending, in terms of trying to find creative ways to keep our costs down. And so we've been able to extend the fiscal stability plan into further and further years. We actually have, as of this date, have not had to touch any of the fiscal stabilization funds. The next slide basically shows you where the fiscal stability stabilization fund is at this point. And the FY17 budget, we were projecting that we would not have to dip into that fund until 2020, I believe, was the projection. So we'll be obviously mindful of that and taking a look at the numbers when we build this budget. Obviously, the longer we can forestall that, the better. But it's there, and one of the pledges that we made to the taxpayers was we would try to forestall that as long as possible, but we would then use those funds, that additional capacity, to be able to support level services and maintain level services, so we would not have to cut. And I'm proud to say that since that override passed, we've had a series of budgets where we haven't had to start with what do we cut in order to maintain level funding. We've been able to maintain level services. So what are the revenue issues for 2018? So overall, we're projecting about a 3% increase, or $2.35 million increase in revenue. 2.5%, which is the allowable increase under Proposition 2.5, is $1.360847. Our new growth estimate, we're using $600,000 as our new growth estimate. We're estimating about a $100,000 increase in local receipts. And then we're showing from the governor's budget about $294,620 in new revenue from the cherry sheet. This is the cherry sheet. We actually took a little snapshot of it. We even colored it cherry for you, just so it's realistic. Basically, when the governor announces his budget, Candy and Susan rush to their computers to download the cherry sheet to see, okay, what does it actually mean? Because, they'll say a lot of flowery things, but what's really important is how does it affect Northampton. So this basically shows you the revenue that's coming in, and it shows you everything from we're getting a whopping $29,000 increase in charter tuition reimbursement. It shows you that $164,000 in unrestricted general government aid that I mentioned. It shows you an increase in veterans benefits, but of course those are benefits we've already paid out. We're being reimbursed on. So that kind of shows you that $294,000 increase. But in addition to the revenue, there's also the next slide, which is the assessment. So they give it and then they take it away. And you can kind of follow down the cherry sheet. The one, of course, that jumps out is, of course, charter school spending tuition is going up $207,145. That's the last number. So that's probably the biggest change in terms of assessment. So that's how we get the offset to know how much net we're expecting, at least under the governor's budget. So What are the expenditure issues for 2018? Well, I've talked about some of the ones that we already know are coming, the retirement assessment, the increase, the cherry sheet assessments of 183,901. We're estimating about $343,000 in additional debt service costs. What we don't know yet, we're waiting on health insurance. Again, a 3% increase in our health insurance would be about $327,000. A 5% increase would be $545,000. Another piece that we're trying to finalize before the budget is collective bargaining, so that we have a clearer understanding. We're still working on that in the city side. There's still some finalization even on the school side. And so that's another piece of the puzzle that we'll be needing to understand. Then, of course, there's the House and Senate versions of the budget. So the other columns in those in that cherry sheet will slowly start to get populated when the House Ways and Means Committee releases their budget, then the Senate Ways and Means, and then the conference, and then we'll the final budget that's approved is we'll sort of know our numbers. Of course, it'll be too late by then. We'll have probably already passed our budget. But we're going to do our best to make the best estimates. And then, of course, department staffing and OM and budget needs. We'll obviously be meeting with the school districts. We'll be meeting with all the departments to understand any individual needs that they have, any department staffing needs, or any particular operations and maintenance needs that they may have to make adjustments in individual budgets. This is the timeline updated to fit with the charter. Actually, tonight, January 31st, we kick off the meeting. We've got a couple of markers in March 2nd, the first meeting in March. I'll be submitting the proposed 2018 water and sewer rates to City Council. That'll also be the date I'm required. It's the latest I can transmit the capital improvement program to the City Council, which is not a spending request. It's just a five-year program for anticipated capital improvements. April 16th is the deadline by which the two school districts have to adopt their budgets and submit them to the mayor. May 16th is the deadline that I have by charter to submit the proposed budget to City Council. May 31st is the deadline for Council to hold its public hearing and vote on the capital improvement program. And then obviously June 30th is the deadline for City Council to have held a public hearing and to have taken a vote on the FY 2018 budget. So that's kind of the timeline from now until kickoff. We'll obviously be trying to look at what's happening at the state level. We'll be trying to finish up some of the collective bargaining issues, and we'll be having those individual meetings with the schools and with city departments, so that by the time we hopefully start to present the budget to the City Council, and hopefully by the time the school committees take their votes, we'll have a clearer picture of what our budget looks like. So that's the presentation, and I'm happy to answer any questions or comments that people have. One hand, there's not a lot of not a lot of variation, not a lot of excitement. That's actually kind of what we like. We've sort of had fairly stable budgets the last 4 years, and again, that's part of the plan. And so, the main issue again comes down to what is the state going to do? There's talk about Chapter 70. There's talk. The governor talked about looking at implementing some of the foundation budget recommendations, which they may be some in there, but it's probably not going to impact Northampton, which is a minimum aid community. So a lot of the new money, I think, that the governor has put into the budget, Northampton isn't going to see in terms of Chapter 70. Local aid, we're getting basically, a percentage based on the increase in revenue. And then the rest of it is going to be, again, up to us to figure out how we create a balanced budget that maintains services in both our schools and city. Counselor?
I can come up with one.
Oh, okay.
I was wondering, when you raised the subject of what tools we have locally to raise our own revenue,
yeah,
precisely because we can't really depend on the state to provide substantial resources, It's my understanding the governor's budget is a proposal to expand the hotel tax, essentially, and allow for short-term rentals. And I don't know if, like Airbnb and those kind of things, taxing those things. And it seemed to me that would be beneficial to Northampton. It seemed to me that would be a thriving sort of business in the city, and then that would be a good tool for us. I don't know if in your travels and discussions you've learned anything about that tool.
We have definitely, that's something we've heard about over the last several years, and we've been waiting for basically for the state to come up with a legislative correction, because right now there's sort of a loophole that you call it couch sharing. I don't know what you call it. What do you call apartment sharing? I don't know what the economy is for Airbnb and for those places, but there's kind of a loophole right now in the laws about collecting fees and taxes. They don't quite fit as a hotel or a motel. They don't fit as like a bed and breakfast. We've heard from a lot of our bed and breakfast owners. Some of you know Craig Della Penna. I've been having an annual conversation with him. You know, he owns a bed and breakfast in Florence. He has to get inspections. He has to pay taxes. He has to collect taxes, et cetera. And his competitors in the Airbnb industry don't. I've heard from our largest hotelier in the city about this as well. And I know that Airbnb itself, in many other jurisdictions, is completely fine with taxation, and they actually manage it, and they, you know, they take care of all the collections of that, and their policy is always we'll follow whatever the local jurisdiction does. The problem has been the ability to do that under mass law. So, you know, the governor's proposing this, and we'll see what happens as it makes its way through the legislature. But I completely agree. I think it's an equity issue. It's a local revenue source that we're not capturing. And again, as a fairness issue, you know, we're having to maintain and attest to the safety and some of the other issues related to this kind of lodging. So it's services that we potentially might have to provide.
Right.
So
I think there was one slide that showed our city is well above neighboring communities in terms of that sector,
totally,
whatever you want to call it, of revenue.
Yeah.
So you would imagine there's a hidden slice there that, I don't know how substantial, but.
Yeah, so I mean, if you go right now, I think there's, you know, in excess of 100 Airbnbs in Northampton,
really?
That come up. So there's a significant amount. Again, you know, maybe once a year, it may be on a weekly basis, I don't know. And I understand the sharing economy do it because they don't have to pay hotel motel fees, but at the same time there is an equity issue and it's a revenue, potential revenue source. So we're definitely, I'm supportive of it, and we'll see how that makes it through the House and Senate.
Okay.
There's similar proposals, obviously the same corollaries with, you know, Lyft and Uber and the way those are treated as well, relative to the taxi cabs and all those. So that's sort of a corollary to that.
What if you sleep in your car, your Uber car? I mean, we won't go there.
You may have a new
another loophole.
Mr. Baird.
So I have two questions. So federal education grants were $1.8 million. Is that pretty stable? Are we seeing increases in those?
No, I can say that the federal grants for education have been stable. They've been flat. In some cases, they've been declining. One of the main factors in that is your poverty rate, which is based, it's a trailing, I think trails 2 years. We just got our update for the next grant cycle. We're up 0.98% in terms of poverty. So I think that would bode for a small positive increase, but not a major increase.
And some of them are just based on, like, we may apply for something 1 year and get it or not get it, or there might be a domestic violence grant, or they may offer, you know, bulletproof vests to police departments. So a lot of it is literally like a grant comes up and they apply for it, and then these you know, Title I and special ed, which are just larger, more regular grants. So
Title I is what I was most interested in.
Yeah.
Do you know, like, roughly what our Title I grant is?
Oh, I can tell you in an odd way. again, the only, and I'm going by our, I'm going by our audited statements, which basically gives a breakdown at the end of each fiscal year, what Title I is, and if I can find it here, glasses. Let's see, Department Department of Ed.
We're racing.
Yeah, it's a race, Title I. Looks like $534,864 in 2016 was Title I.
Did you get some too?
Grants.
Yeah.
So can you say that again?
$534,864. Special education, $983,401. And actually then career and voc tech, about $115,169. What's that? It says career and tech education, basic grants to states, occupational, vocational. Doesn't say Perkins anywhere, but it's probably
Earl Perkins money.
Yeah, Earl Perkins money. So that's really what Title I is.
So my other question was around the charter school spending. So I looked at the comparison graph and then the Northampton graph, and there's a real difference in the per student net loss. So if you look at the Northampton one, it was around $23,000 per net loss cost. But if you look at the surrounding communities, it was a little bit about $11,000 per student in terms of like a net loss.
We all pay a different rate, and it's based on our individual foundation budget rate. So what we pay to send a kid to Hilltown is different than what East Hampton pays. So we get a tuition rate that's set by the state for each of the five schools we send our kids to, and it's based on, their magic formula. The other thing, as I've talked about many times, is not only do they base it on your foundation spending, but they also base it on your above foundation spending. So the more, as I've said before, we lose $2.5 million to charters, we pass a $2.5 million override, and then they increase our charter school tuition because we're spending more. And so even though we're ostensibly trying to use that money to plug the hole because we're losing the money, it doesn't matter. The more we spend, the more they take and give to charters. So am I getting that accurately?
You are. I would just throw one more thing into it. It makes a big difference whether your school that you're sending a child to is another public school district through the choice program or whether it's a charter school through the charter program. So, you can see some schools on this list that actually have a net positive and are still in a negative balance, probably because they're sending more students to charter and taking them in through the choice.
The other thing about this chart was, it's really small, but we're looking at Northampton. So in this year, we're losing 62, net loss of 62 students, and we're losing 895,000. Then you go to the other slide before it.
It's like 40 here, something, yeah.
And where is it? Where'd it go? 45 students, and we're losing more money. We're losing $1 million. So there's really no, there are years when the reimbursement, the costs go up, but the number of students is less. Because of the factor, the change in the factors based on your above net school spending. So it's just, it continues to be a challenge. And so we'll see. Obviously, in the wake of the defeat of question two, and I know that the Senate and the House have talked about trying to focus in on the foundation budget report and trying to address some of those issues. I don't know. It's funny. There's a slide on the DESE spreadsheet for charter school that used to be on there. It was a column that used to be on there, where it basically showed you this is how much we're giving you in charter school funding, and then there was an extra slide that said this is how much we're supposed to be giving you in charter school funding. They've gotten rid of that. This is how much we're supposed to be. I think they were just embarrassed. But it used to be it would show that we were getting how many hundred thousand less. Now, maybe they haven't calculated it, but we did notice this year that little chart or that little column has gone away.
So if I could just add on to that, just doing some quick mental math in my head, this you have to read the slides backwards to go forward in time. So this one is 2016 with all the different colors in the districts. And then the one that just refers to Northampton is 2017. So you're having a net loss of 15 fewer students, but it cost you $100,000 more in terms of your tuition out funding. So it, I think, just underscores the inequity in the formulas.
Mr. President.
So my takeaway from this and every other presentation you've given us is that we are left to our own devices, and our devices actually have been well maintained under your aegis, and very impressively, because the state and federal commitments, the federal commitments are laughable. It should be noted that, and the state commitment, it's continually diminish, and we move away from progressive taxation and more into regressive taxation, back into property taxes, and create a bigger onus on the community. Your aggressive pursuit of alternative means to offset that have paid big dividends. And it also serves, provides us with graphs to actually drill down and get a sense of what our local economy is like. And in that respect, for instance, is the reflection of increased collected fees without increases in those fees means that there is a stable business pattern that's already established here. Not a guarantee, but certainly one that's a lot more robust than's been described in the past. So, I mean, I just want to commend you again, and Susan, and everyone who's participated in this process, but you guys in particular, that what you have set up is a superstructure that functions within the dysfunction. And I think that's very admirable, and I'm very grateful.
So. Thank you. The only other thing I was going to add, because you mentioned about local options, there are, MMA has filed a couple of bills this year to try to create some other local options. Well, one of them actually is a local option tax that you could add a sort of a small percentage you could add to alcohol, and it would be specifically earmarked for public health, for basically dealing with addiction. And public health, as we know, many communities are grappling with. That's one potential source of revenue. The other one is there's a bill filed by MMA that would allow to increase the 0.75% on the meals and hotel the meals tax to go up to 1.5 as an option. Right now, we're allowed to go up to 0.75 above and beyond the regular sales tax on meals in Massachusetts. So that 0.75 stays. I know MMA, again, you know, we're in our fiscal stability plan, you know, we were, you know, using an estimate of like 1% increase in local aid, you know, thinking like, okay, that's laughable, it's conservative, and no, we're not even gonna hit 1%. So we really are really now having to just maintain stability, hope something changes at the state level, but then also look at potential other revenue sources.
Well, I no knock on you, but I think the hope on the state level is not the optimistic prospect. But this also leads me to a follow-up on one of the resources that you were investigating and actually soliciting was the payment in lieu of taxes, a potential significant contribution that would offset the greater burden on the community paying their own regressive taxation. Do you have an update on how that's going and the contributions that have been offered so far by the larger institutions in the city?
Yeah, so you know, we did introduce a program in the last year that I talked about in the FY 2016 budget. We went through obviously a large public process. I had meetings in multiple wards, town hall meetings. I had meetings with the 10 largest tax exempt property owners. We made requests, and we have received some responses. Our two largest tax exempt institutions declined to participate in the program, declined to participate but made contributions, so or committed to a contribution, but did not want to actually call it a pilot payment or participate in receiving community credits or anything like that. So we did receive a commitment from Smith College for $100,000 a year for 3 years. Cooley Dickinson, $10,000 a year for 3 years. Interestingly, among the smaller tax exempts, we had two institutions that did make a full, again, 5% of what their tax bill would be, and then the remaining institutions similarly did not opt to participate, did not feel they had the ability. So, you know, as I said from the start, it's a voluntary program. We tried to lay out a very, you know, I thought well thought out program. We made the ask. So again, that is revenue that we didn't have before we started this process, and it'll be about $115,000 roughly that we'll be using toward the capital plan this year, because it's technically one-time money. We can't be guaranteed guaranteed revenue source. And then we'll just continue to have those conversations year after year with those institutions. The bill has been refiled by MMA that would basically codify the ability of cities and towns to do this. But again, as I said, it was a potential revenue source that I feel like made a strong effort to try to go after, and we're going to continue to work on it over time.
So those institutions, if they're watching, the invitation's still open, and if they feel so inclined?
Yes. Okay. And we've had, you know, we've also had some other, you know, we have a new medical marijuana dispensary, which we did sign a long-term agreement, a host agreement, that they are making some annual payments to us. And we've also signed a long-term pilot agreement with the three county fairgrounds as well. Again, that they weren't part of that program, but we have worked with some of our other agencies in the city, again, to seek out new forms of revenue.
Right. They weren't on the original ask list.
They would not have been. No, they would have been exempt. Yeah.
Thank you.
Yep. Councilor Klein.
First of all, I'd like to say thank you to under your stewardship and Susan Wright's stewardship. I feel like we have a very positive picture here, and I appreciate that. But I wanted to ask, and I think I asked this last year as well, about green infrastructure, and if in the future we can kind of have that worked into the presentation, what kind of savings we're creating through the creation of the green infrastructure that we're investing in, and really be able to kind of have an overlay of what the costs would be without that green infrastructure in place. And then I just had another quick question that maybe is irrelevant. If we know any more, I know we kind of have dodged the bullet with the casino in Springfield because of the delay in the building, but if we know any more kind of about how that potentially is going to affect kind of downtown economy and so forth.
Yeah. On the green infrastructure or the savings, I mean, that is something that we try to include in our budget, not necessarily in this presentation, but certainly when you look at our budgets for central services at DPW, we're always trying to tout under the accomplishments, you know, what we're saving in terms of things like the LED light initiative, things like the landfill array that's under construction. So we will be trying to show those kinds of savings that, and then just the regular work we've done across all of our facilities to put in more energy efficient controls and change out lights and do all those things to reduce our energy costs. And you know, we did a bunch of conversions several years ago off of oil to gas, and we're continuing to try to find new ways to use cleaner and greener energy. So that's a good point, and we are always trying to highlight the savings there.
If we can even see it in comparison to the other communities too, because I think that could really show us the benefit of doing that.
Yeah, we can definitely try. Again, we're sort of dependent on what kind of data DESE collects, but we can certainly look at that, maybe look at some energy consumption trends or something like that. I mean, we were one of the first green communities in the state. We continue to reap benefits from that. We continue to use our SREX monies that we get from our existing solar arrays and reinvest it back into green energy projects. We've been recognized, statewide and nationally for those efforts.
and we're going to continue. If you've been out to the landfill lately, you've seen the array that's just about finished construction. That's going to again be generating three and a half megawatts of green energy, and that's going to significantly reduce our energy. So that's a good point. The casino, definitely the casino is part of the things we're looking at in terms of downtown, and it's definitely a constant conversation point with the new DNA chamber and a lot of the regional tourism boards. And it is something that we're doing some work on. Obviously, we attempted to become a surrounding community. We were not successful. We are exploring some other possibilities around mitigation now that the casino is closer to realization. And so we are having some conversations with the Gaming Commission about that. It remains a concern of mine in terms of what the impacts will be in terms of restaurants, entertainment. Obviously, there's been other casinos built in other regions since then, and the two tribes are rushing to build a joint casino on the Connecticut border as well. So it's definitely something we're continuing to focus on, and it's definitely a constant conversation that I have with business leaders and with the chamber and with the DNA. So we'll just try to keep you posted on that. I would say also to your point, Terry Masterson, our economic development director, has been collecting economic data on primarily on our downtown economy. We're about to release an update for basically all of 2016. So that'll be coming out in the next couple of days. That kind of gives you that picture of things like vacancies and hotel motel and kind of collects it all in one place. So we're going to be doing an update on that soon. We were hoping to get it done for tonight, but obviously we had a lot of other stuff going on. But we're hoping the next day or two to update that. Yes.
First off, thank you so much for making it comprehensible and comprehensive. I guess my question is when you present the budget in a way that makes it look like we're able to sort of buffer any effects that the state economy has at the local level, and I'm wondering how that plays out right now with so much going on at the national level. Is the state able to kind of mitigate any changes that happen at the federal level, or is there something in particular that we should be concerned about that could alter funding, like that the federal funding could affect the state and then trickle down?
I there's definitely a lot to be concerned about at the federal level. Some of the social social safety net programs that will surely, they haven't gotten to those yet, but surely I foresee when the president does his budget, they'll probably be, there's a lot of talk about block granting, which is always the stock thing that we're going to do. We're going to block grant, which means we're going to, package it all up in a smaller package and give it to you and say, you're on your own. And obviously the impacts on the Affordable Care Act and the potential, Massachusetts has been able to be a leader in providing near universal health care because we've been able to get Medicare waivers in order to do that. There's a question. I know the governor has sent a letter expressing his concerns about changes to the ACA. There's a concern about what that would do to our healthcare system, which is going to have a ripple effect throughout the entire healthcare economy, including the healthcare for municipalities. So that definitely is something. When you look at that 10 million approaching 11 million, which is all over 10% of our budget, what happens in the healthcare economy could have a big effect. And then the education funding. We talk about the 3.4 million as being a small percentage of the overall budget, but it's primarily programs like Title I, like special ed, like school lunches, like CDBG, which allows us to serve low and moderate income people. It's a lot of the money that we don't tend to have extra money lying around to be able to do those things with tax revenue. So that 3 million is really important money. And obviously we know in the school department how important it is to have a Title I reading instructor in a school and the difference that can make. So to lose Title I funding, that could be significant. So very concerned about it, and obviously, you know, at the MMA meeting, that was a big topic of discussion. I had a mayor's meeting, which we were all mass mayors, and we had, you know, the governor and our two senators, and Mike, Congressman Capuano, who's a former mayor, and that was a lot of the discussion was about how they were all going to be working on ways to kind of create a bulwark against some of those impacts. And transportation funding, obviously, is a big one as well. We have a huge amount of projects. The Green Line in Boston is a big project that needs to be finished. And so, they know, and they're mindful, and they're hearing it from MMA, and I'm sure they're hearing it from MASC and MASS, that what happens at the federal level can have a big ripple effect. So, you know, keep calling your representatives. But again, we also can't lose focus on the State House as well. And, you know, I'm you know, the governor's budget is the governor's budget. There's some good stuff in it. Again, I wish there was more creativity, more vision. But, you know, when you start from a premise that there's not going to be any new revenue, not going to be any new, you know, anything like that. The other thing to keep in mind is in the next couple of years, we have the opportunity to put the ballot question that is a potential significant revenue source for education and for transportation, which is the so-called millionaire's tax, which was another topic of discussion. I think that's going to be a major campaign over the next couple of years to get that on the ballot, because I think that the polling shows that people would support that. And that's another way to sort of go around the legislature to create revenue if they're not going to do it. Other question? Councilor Bidwell.
Your illustration of how Agawam has chosen to use its free cash
yeah.
to accumulate in general funds as opposed to allocating
yeah.
to stabilization funds. Is there any particular advantage to maintaining flexibility that way, or do the rating agencies penalize you for not putting it in stabilization funds? What are the pros and cons?
Not at all. I mean, we've done it. I actually asked Mayor Cohen about that today, because I said I was looking at a chart with Agawam. Agawam has a lot of room under its levy limit. They have a lot of capacity, which, as he jokes, all of us are scared to touch. But they just, for whatever reason, they're kind of a smaller city. I don't know how many enterprise funds they have specifically, but, you know, we've chosen to do it because we just feel like it's a more transparent way to kind of allocate your resources. We've obviously developed debt plans. We've also financial policies that talk about, you know, we want to have a capital stabilization fund. We want to get it to a certain percentage. Then we'll start to draw from it for capital projects. You know, so we've set out pretty clear fiscal policies. The other obvious reason, although I believe it may have changed since then, is, you know, stabilization fund is generally, under most charters, it takes a simple majority to move money out of free cash. It generally takes a two-thirds majority to move money out of a stabilization account. I don't know if that's changed or not. He told me that he thought it had changed, but it's sort of irrelevant for Northampton because our charter requires a supermajority vote for financial transactions. But I think that's the other reason. But we just feel like, because we have the different enterprise funds, you know, one of the things we just did over the last several years is we used to just have a free cash balance that was just kind of turning over in the, much like Agawam, in the water and sewer funds. And we wanted to really show people, by actively transferring that balance into a stabilization fund, that we're using it to build up for capital projects. So that's why actually DOR in one case said we really needed to do it. And so we've set up now stabilization funds in each one of our enterprise funds, and then we have the key stabilization funds. So we just think it's a clearer way to kind of show the different types of reserves that we have, and what we would use them for in the future. Because the other thing that you see with free cash is your free cash is turning over as well. So when you look at that number, you know, when you look at Agawam's, you know, $12 million, it doesn't tell you how much of that was last year's free cash. You know what I mean? It doesn't tell you, what's new and what was just in the fund. It doesn't actually tell you how much new free cash they yielded, because they're just letting it roll over and roll over and roll over. You know, we're actively, we get it, we're moving it into our capital program, we're then putting it into our stabilization funds. We do keep a little bit of free cash at the end of the year, because we don't want to not have any in case of an emergency. But pretty much by the end of the year, we're down to, you know, $200,000-$300,000. So that's about all that's rolling over. So I just think it's a more, a clearer, more transparent way to budget. Okay. Plus, the other thing with free cash is it goes away on June 30th. That's the other major problem, is when June 30th rolls around, you can't touch your free cash until it's recertified. So that $12 million for about 4 or 5, 6 months, Agawam can't touch it. Mm-hmm. So that's the other advantage to moving it into a stabilization fund. I should have led with that. But that's the other reason to put it in a stabilization fund, is that if you have an emergency, you can't touch it if it hasn't been recertified. So that's the other advantage.
Thanks.
I have a really brief, concrete question. Looking at the pie chart of the federal funding, going back to the question about how federal funds could be affected, the HHS money, is that specifically the CDBG funds?
Say that one again.
Is the HHS money?
HUD would be CDBG. HHS is most likely public health funds, either for the health department or potentially the public health nurse in the schools.
And the $64,000 Homeland Security funding, what is that?
Generally, it's grants that come from time to time. Again, it may be for tactical equipment. It may be for bulletproof vests. It tends to be their grants that are available. Sometimes they come through the state, and the state and the cities and towns are allowed to apply. You know, when I look at the pie chart and I think about the threat that the president has made, or his executive order, which really just instructs the Secretary of Homeland Security to review ways to cut federal funding. Probably about the only one they could touch would be that DHS, Department of Homeland Security, because really case law and statute says that you can tie strings to any federal program, but it has to have some nexus to actually the money and the program in question. So that's one area that they could, but you know, most legal scholars say, you know, you can't, it'll be very difficult to tie enforcement of one area of federal government to Title I funding, which is part of a federal law, basically, that's been enacted by Congress. So I know people are concerned about it. I'm less concerned about it. And I think there's strong legal arguments, you know, 10th Amendment arguments for why, and then just, you know, case law and just congressional lawmaking in general, why it's, you know, the stroke of a pen cannot remove federal funding from a whole class of municipalities, which is why he didn't do it. And really, his executive order says, please review it, see if we can do it, figure out if there's a way to do it. Which he could have asked me, I could have saved him a lot of time. Yes.
Thank you so much. As everybody has said, it's an incredible presentation, and you know, I hope the whole city watches.
The one thing I know it's mind numbing because you see all these bar charts, but the big thing to keep in mind is like our municipal expenses go like this. And all the aid charts go like this. I mean, that's the one takeaway you get from this, is that, and that's why the math just never works at the municipal level, because the expenses go up and the aid charts remain flat. So
yeah, no, I really hope that the community does watch this. I really hope that the people who, you know, work in our schools watch it, and the parents look at it, and you know, become active in it. My question is sort of a reminder, and it could be because my brain is so consumed with executive orders right now. Will you or the superintendent remind me, how is Chapter 70 decide, how do they break the numbers down? Because those are different for each community as well. So what are a few of the factors that go into who gets more Chapter 70 money? I would imagine the standard things, but yeah. Also kind of for a public discourse so that the citizens of
I can try to explain it, but I bet Dr. Provost can probably do a better job if you're willing.
Just to throw in a few key drivers of the formula. Property value, local median income, and enrollment numbers, I think, are the three strongest drivers in that whole formula, although there are a number of factors. But I would guess that more than half of the variance in that formula is driven by those three variables alone.
Mass Budget and Tax Policy Center has a great video, a couple of great tutorial videos where they basically show you and show you, you know, how the formula is constructed. And they take some sample communities and they talk about, you know, this community, you know, their foundation requirement is here, this community is here, which means, you know, this is, it determines how much Chapter 70 they're going to get and how much they're required to spend. And it really shows you how the formula is applied. The problem, of course, is that over time, there's now like 230 or 240 minimum aid communities. So the vast majority of us are in that category of minimum aid. Now, again, there's plenty of reasons. You know, obviously, we have gateway cities in the Commonwealth, which have a lot of big challenges. And so I understand why a lot of the resources are being directed there. But at the same time, you know, we're trying to still deliver a quality education. There's more and more mandates that are being placed on us, more and more challenges, and yet we're given, you know, $20 per child in our district for a whopping $57,000 between the two districts of an increase when we know, our cable bill goes up more than that probably, or, you know, whatever it is, pick a really small line item, goes up more than that. So that's the big challenge. You know, the reform efforts that have been talked about, there's always been the big question of if you rejigger the formula, then, you know, there's going to be winners and losers. And so, but the big thing is that the foundation budget itself doesn't truly represent the cost of providing education to students. It's way out of date. It way underestimates health insurance. It way underestimates special education costs. And they already know the answer. You know, the answer is they got to put a lot more money into Chapter 70, which, again, maybe we're not going to be rolling in it, but that $20, if it was $100, what a difference that would make. I mean, imagine if we got a $100 per child increase. That would be a big jump from $20. But you got to have more revenue to do that. You either got to cut somewhere else or you got to be willing to raise revenue. That's why, again, I think the millionaire's tax might be a way to create that new revenue. It kind of goes around the whole, you know, flat tax that we have in Massachusetts. So we'll see.
When you said that they set the insurance rates in 2 or 3 weeks, are those allowed to change or do they have to honor those for the full year?
They honor for the full year, yeah.
Even if they're extenuating circumstances, they're not allowed to change those? Those are definitely the numbers?
Oh, they're the numbers, okay. Yeah. And to their credit, GIC has been doing a really good job. You know, they have a new executive director, and they there's actually a good story about it today in the Boston Herald. You know, they've been really clamping down on some of the more expensive hospitals around Boston. They've actually frozen three of the plans, and they're not allowing them to accept any new members because they've come in with such high rates. You know, ironically, Harvard Pilgrim, the governor's old company, is one of them. But that's, you know, again, it's Harvard Pilgrim. It's sort of the Cadillac kind of insurance, really expensive hospitals. So they put a cap on they're not allowing any people to enroll in Harvard Pilgrim. They've done it to a couple of others. So they're really trying to actually the story in the Herald today, I think it's the Herald, is about how the GIC is really taking a leadership role in trying to keep state health care costs down by not just accepting these incredible increases, but by using their buying power of all the state employees to really force these hospitals, insurers, to keep their costs down. So no, they can't change it. They give us the GIC has a board which is made up of municipal representation, labor, different sectors. They meet with their actuaries. They actually go out to bid to all the plans. they submit prices, they make change, plan design changes, and then once those rates are that, yeah, you get your little booklet, those are the rates for all the different plans. And they know that they're bidding on rates for a year, and they have to stick with those rates. So, yeah. So there shouldn't be any big surprises. The surprise will be what is the increase. And it's not really, you know, the overall plan, the increase might be, you know, they sometimes, they advertise when they announce what the GIC is doing, they do, they use a blended rate of all the plans, like what the increase is. We're obviously going to be focusing on Health New England and, you know, the plans that predominantly people in Northampton, that, that's going to be the real driver for us. Because really we're not, many of our people aren't subscribing to the Eastern Mass plans. So we'll see. We did have a meeting with our employees this year with representatives from all the different unions, which is part of the whole health care reform. And because we were coming to the end of our three-year renewal for GIC, and actually we had our insurance consultant actually go out to bid, basically ask other insurance companies, would you bid on us if we got out of the GIC? And the bids we got were way higher, and in two or three cases, they didn't want to bid. They just didn't want to bid. Like, they just said, we're not going to bid. You know, we provided them with a three-year history of our claims and gave them all the data. And again, it was a better deal to stay in the GIC. So we're staying in the GIC. It's now a two-year renewal. And again, I think that it saved us significantly, and we're sort of harnessing the bargaining power of all state employees plus a whole host of municipalities when we're, which is a lot different than 1,000 employees in the city trying to negotiate with a health insurance provider. Councilor LaBarge.
Yes, Mayor, I want to thank you, and I want to thank Susan Wright for a well put together on this presentation. I also would like to know, Mayor, on the unions. I know we always go through this where you're negotiating and working with the unions. How are we doing with that?
Well, as I said, we are getting close to finalizing. My hope is that I will be coming to the City Council, hopefully either in, later in February, hopefully early March, and as you know, we'll probably have an executive session, and we'll talk about the bargaining among the various city units, and then make any budgetary adjustments. But it is this year, for a variety of reasons, bargaining has taken longer. In some cases, we've had more in-depth bargaining. I'm looking at some of my colleagues on the school committee who've had some really in-depth bargaining, which has been great and productive. It's just taken more time than in the past. We've had some situations where some of our bargaining units decided to change representation and go with a totally different parent unit, and that delayed the process. And so it's, you know, we're hoping that we're going to have it completed, because obviously knowing what our FY17 wages are important for us to know what our FY18 wages are to build the FY18 budget. So we're working on that. Obviously, to give you more detail, I'd prefer to do an executive session to talk about bargaining strategy. But we're hoping that we're going to get it all completed in time to build the FY18 budget. Okay. Any other questions? I guess I would entertain a motion to adjourn this special joint meeting.
Adjourn.
Second.
There's a second. All those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Any abstentions? The joint meeting is adjourned.